development, that is by yourself, as I explained earlier. And second one, you could acquire someone, acquire a person who would match your requirement, acquire a person, and especially I said, when it comes into the fragmented market, it might even good to acquire a smaller company with a smaller market share, because that market share could be added on to yours. Or you can even merge with other companies. Yeah. And the third way of growing is like through strategic alliance. I mentioned that, you know, we are already in alliance with Danish companies. That's what we started off with as well. So probably we can even look at more companies. We see some Norway also in the picture. So we could acquire, we could have a strategic alliance with the other companies also, in the forms of either by franchising or by licensing, you know, to give the perfect product what our customer wants. The essence of this is like, you know, if I had to say, let's say if you're looking at on a practical aspect of it, okay, on our life practical aspect of it, the organic development is equivalent to a person who would want to earn, who would want to get qualified, who would want to build a house, who would want to buy a car, who would have sufficient amount of funds in the bank account, then look for the partner. The merger acquire would be, merge is like, you know, two parents getting together, you know, giving their concern. So that's what the merge is anyway, would take place. So you would have, your bride might have his property, his money. The bridegroom would have, you know, his property and his money. So then they join together, you know, they would have bigger amount of money. I hope that, you know, bride and the bridegroom are willing to share their money with their partners. But then that's how the merger would work. Or even you can acquire, like you can elope with someone who has enough properties, okay? That's what we do in the acquisition, right? We go against the, even the will of the management. You know, we could buy from the shareholders, and we could even remove the management team out of it, and we can have our own management team in, right? So that's what generally the acquisition, that's what it happens, right? The strategic alliance is, you know, which is very famous now, which is becoming a popular trend in Sri Lankan concern. It's living together. Okay, you mind your business, I will mind my business. You pay this, I pay this. You pay the rent, I do the groceries. You do this, I do this. You have your vehicle, I'll have my vehicle. You know, whatever said and done. Yes, we are living under one roof, but then that's for pure convenience. Yeah, pure convenience. So same way with strategic alliances, right? You know, you can use the assets, but then you can't own them. Yeah, you can get the benefit out of it, like what I talked to you about the collaboration in the airlines. Yeah, so you can use their intellectual properties, but then you don't own them. Yeah, so you have the license to manufacture, but you don't own the processes. You have it's borrowed, so you have to pay for it. Yeah, so that's how it works. So giving that perspective, these are the ways that, you know, even PIA can think of growing. Up to now, as I said, PIA has grown by itself following an organic method. So PIA can think of growing through mergers or acquisition. Even merging, they might think twice because of the concept of the senior entrepreneurs who started this business, Samuel and his brother-in-law. But acquisition might be possible, whether they would like to take that option, bringing in a new set of person into the system. Yeah, because if it is not compatible, that's why most of the mergers and acquisition fail. If it is not compatible, then that is not going to survive. Okay, that relationship is not going to survive. Yeah, like in the normal world, you know. So you are even a proper marriage could end up in divorce, or even a acquisition might end up in divorce or whatever. But that's how it is. Okay, so if you don't properly evaluate whom are you going to acquire or whom are you going to merge, then you might get into this problem because the systems might not be compatible. Yeah, the processes might not be compatible. That's the reason. So the organization with a culture of hierarchy and respect to the seniors and listening to the seniors and totally controlled by the seniors would think twice before acquiring or merging. They might prefer to stay with their organic development itself. So the next one, now we have finished the number one and number three method of pursuing strategies. Now we are going into the rationalization, that is a strategic direction. Okay. It's an ANSOS matrix. It's two variables that we are looking at. We are looking at the when the organizational top ranks decide that how they want to grow their businesses, whether it could be organic development, merge acquire, or even strategic alliance, they could go on the direction what ANSOS matrix talked about. We had two options, two variables, the market and the product. Okay, so the option was either to remain in the same market or enter into the new market, right? Now you need to be aware here, you can be in the same market and also you can acquire somebody who is operating in the same market. Okay, by that you're enlarging, by that you're growing. Okay, that is also possible, right? You can be in the same market, but you could acquire somebody who are not producing the same product. So that's why it goes as a market development. So that is one. So you need to check on those line. The other one, in terms of the products, also you could have two aspect of it. Either you sell the existing product in the same market, or you develop the new products to go off with. So that could be shown on the ANSOS matrix. Your market penetration, that is the existing product with the existing market. Your market development, taking the same product into the new market. Your product development, bringing in new products to the existing market, and diversification. Okay, so if you look at the market penetration, easy example I can give you is like your toothpaste market. Yeah, you all were brushing earlier only in the night, or sorry, in the morning. Yeah, then they said better to brush in the night also, otherwise bacteria will have a big fight and all those things. They made that pheocycosis in your mind and showing small insects in your mouth, and they made you to brush in the night also. What happens? Immediately, your volume doubles. Morning also you're brushing now, evening also you're brushing with the toothpaste. Volume doubles. Now, not only that volume doubles, your brush also need to be replaced soon. Yeah, because you're using not twice, okay? Now what are the situation? Now you have to brush 5 times. That's what they are recommending after meals also. So products connected to that also the sales are increasing, okay? So mouthwash, your toothpaste, your toothbrush, you know, giving the data about, you know, 3 out of 5 children having, you know, tooth decays, all these things, creating that fear psychosis, they could sell, no, those are the tactics that they do, okay? But then this is where they could sell more products in the existing market. Now, you could even acquire another, let's say, for example, hypothetically, I don't think that will ever happen. Signal acquires Cloguard or Cloguard acquires Signal. Okay. So then what's happening? If Cloguard acquires Signal, brilliant, their market share increases, they become the almost the entire market because those are the two major products competing in the market. They become the entire market and they could sell more products in the market. Okay, so their market share is increased, happy, right? So that's how it goes. Your market extension, taking the present product to new markets. Now, easy classic example would be your malt drinks. Okay, your malt drinks. Think about it. These malt drinks earlier was graded or branded as the sick brands, no? When people get sick, that's why you take Horlicks. That's why, you know, because, you know, they can't eat or so they can, you know, have that drink so that, you know, they will have energy. So it was Horlicks, Viva, Nestemalt, all these malted drinks were, you know, on the categorization of the sick market. Now what? Now whoever who wants to be energetic from the morning, yeah? Luckily, they are not saying to replace your national drink, but then that also they said then now they have stopped advertising on that way. So they are saying add with your national drink, that is tea. They are saying to add with that, you know, to make it better. You know, so that, you know, that's how they are advertising, so that, you know, they are linking that national tea because that's something that is always the people of Sri Lanka would always have it. Yeah. So and we have a very small segment that would have coffee in the morning. Right. So that's how it works. You can see that now they're taken into that particular market. So not only stopping there, they're taking it to the kids market for the kids also. Yeah, for the people who are jumping around, going about. So give Nestemalt, give that, give this. Taking your, so again, a new market segment being identified. So they're expanding that from a, going into a new market. That's one. You can do a product development also. That is for the same customer, same market, same people, touch their purse a little bit more than what they used to do. Yeah. So you're grabbing more money from their purse. You know, you can see the fabric softness now. All these years you will be having, now that has been there for some time now, but then that was brought in for the same market where the people were washing. And now they want to the fabric to be more softer now. Same thing. They're bringing the new product in. Okay. They are bringing the new product into the same existing market what they were in. Okay. Then the diversification. Totally new product, new market. This is where the risk comes in. Yeah, I'm just showing the risk by the red lines. The more and more you move towards from the first area, okay, the risk start increasing. Yeah, risk is increased when you move on to product development, to market extension, to diversification, the risk start increasing. The more risky is the diversification, then the product development, then the extension with some arguments, okay? That is according to the thinking what I am in, because for product development you need a lot of investments to make to create that new product. Okay, so the product fails, the total investment on the product is lost, right? And then you have to keep on modifying the product, and still that product might not be you know, good enough to the market. But if you go on a market extension, if that market is not accepting your product, you always can get back to your same market because you have already had a market, okay? You already had a market. So you can always get back to the market because there is no modification made on the, to the product. So you could still continue to manufacture the product and still you will have the market to cater. But the new market, if it does not accept, then you go back to the old market. So the money invested comparatively between the product development and market extension might not be so, it might not be related, okay? It might not be there. Beyond diversification, where you can go related diversification or unrelated diversification. If you look at the way PIA has gone about, the first one, the second one, and the third one, they don't have very close relationship. But the first and the second, if you're looking at the household, when they started off with the household, they have, but still they have gone into a new market into with the new product. So they are now, that is where the entire problem comes in. The initial expertise of the founders, which were in mechanical engineering, motors, the hydro motors. Now, the second generations, they are bringing in, or the third generation, they are bringing in the diversified portfolio, furniture, audiovisual. It's diversified and it's a totally different market. So that's why probably you could see that they are struggling, and you could see that that comment being said, because the culture is such that the top management team would have that parental guidance for your other SBUs. What they feel is the managers or the CEOs of that particular organization, what they feel is that, the expertise don't come in because they don't know anything about it. They don't know anything about it. Yeah. So that's why they want to, that's why they're saying professionally need to be managed. So respective organizations, that's why they're given an opportunity to bring in the professionals who would manage that particular organization. And they are good in managing, right? So remember that. So diversification could be related diversification, unrelated diversification. So if the PIA would have gone in with the start of their hydro motor business, maybe the related diversification would have been the tubes and the valves and that kind of thing, what is related to their motors to go in. Yeah, and that's a related diversification that they can go through. It is not the same thing, but it's a different thing, but it's related. Okay. So they would have brought in the purification systems, which is related, but it's a diversified thing. Now you could see that there is an opportunity for that, because the government is now interested in providing purified drinking water to the people, free from chemicals, yeah, because of these infamous kidney issues. Yeah, so probably they are moving into an area related diversification. All this time they were not in a related diversification, they were on an unrelated diversification. So you can think like what PIA could do further, to grow, whether they could have a strategic alliance or even they could acquire an organization which would provide these purification plants. There are enough and more plants even in Danish, even there are enough and more plants in Norway, there are enough and more plants in Sweden of this water purification area. When I was searching for information, I wondered why we have not thought about it some time back. Why can't we invest? Why can't we do this? if you are really interested in people and want to reduce the health cost down, you know, you can allocate the health cost. You know, if you are spending so much of billions on your budget, you can invest on that water plants, and you can completely eradicate the the pure water issue in the areas. You know, anyway, that's a different story. Okay, so probably that might be an opportunity for them to grow. There might be opportunity for them to work things out, because it is already been mentioned and said. Okay, they are talking about that in the case itself, right? So that's an opportunity that what you could identify as well. Okay, so your strategic options, now you know, okay, whether you want to base yourself on price or whether you want to base yourself in differentiation. So if you want to base yourself in differentiation, you can still think of a diversification. If you want to think of a diversification, you can either go on alliance, or even you can do organic, or even you can invest. Yeah, or even you can go acquire a company, or you can even invest on your own, right? So any options that you can take. Now, that's why I said there is enough strategic options that you can create for the growth of the organization to move forward. Right. Why I took this particular area for explanation or to discuss is because we see plenty of portfolios in our organization. Okay, plenty of portfolios in our organization. So whether once again, like the Ansoff matrix, there are two variables, market attractiveness and business strength, for a simple reason. Okay, you can go and check on your GE matrix also. GE matrix also is another portfolio analysis which you can do. I'm not doing GE matrix here, but if you're interested, you can check on the GE matrix in detail, right? That is also very similar to this. So here, why I'm taking this is quite easier to identify, so that you know you can link it up with your case. Your industry annual growth versus your strength of your organization. Yeah, whether you're market leader, because there are very little information about the current situation where PIA operates. The market situation is very limited. They're not given any big details, okay? But therefore, don't compare with another organization. Although the Samuel name would, you know, give you a hint or hinge or whatever it is, the type of organization the examiners are looking at, but then, you know, it is not the case always, okay? So you need to be aware of that. And when it says, you know, it started from north, then obviously, you know, there are few organizations which started in the north. So you can have a good wild guess, but I don't want you to guess and go on that particular direction. So industry growth and market share. Now, as a whole, as a complete whole, organization PIA, as a corporate decision, they can decide out of their 8 or 9 SBUs what they have in 3 different companies, what they manage, which one would be the best to take forward. Do we have our cash cow? So probably your hydro might be a cash cow. Yeah, looking at the figures, looking at the way it is, it has settled down. The market is, whether it is growing or not, that you have to see. If it is not growing, then where the market and whether we are capturing that market, yeah, whether it is moving towards that particular aspect of it, whether you're stagnant. Because when you look at the profit portfolio, you know, you're looking at 198, 191. So you're just there. You're not doing anything very, very different. Although there is a net sales, you know, there is a percentage, about 10% growth, but still it's not reflecting on your bottom line. Simply because your cost of sales have increased, you know, by more than the percentage of your revenue. So, you know, few things are there. So that clearly indicates that, you know, the cost of sales have increased and so forth. So we don't know, but it looks healthy. Okay. So we don't have much detail about the market standings, the industry standings of any of the three products. All what we know is that they manufacture and produce good quality products to, you know, to move off with. So therefore, that these products are acceptable by the market, and that's why they're able to remain in the market. Okay. So you have to have a view that how you are going to fund it. Whether your audiovisuals would be a question mark, whether your furnitures would be going as a star, or any one of the those that will be dropped down as a dog, you need to wait and see. Okay, because we don't have any data in that, but have that in mind. Whatever the portfolio that you're going in, we have to, on a financial perspective, as I said, we might have to decide whether to hold it or whether to sell it off. If you feel that, you know, that any one of the portfolio members are into a dog category, that means they are operating on a low growth industry and having a very minimal market share. So it's ideal time for them to be kicked out. But before they be kicked out of your portfolio, you have to look for three things. Number one, whether they are producing. Now, management accounting is now been dominating here. So whether they are producing a revenue, whether they are producing a contribution. Yeah, whether the contribution has been produced. Because if a contribution is produced, that will give you a supplementary into your fixed cost. Okay, so that will support your reduction in, you know, covering up your fixed cost element. So if that SBU can survive, yeah, with a contribution, then think twice before you kick it out. That's one. Number two, see whether that SBU has any relationship with your top portfolio. Yeah, whether you should have that portfolio in your portfolio for that, you know, the top portfolio will survive. Now, say for example, when you say Nestle and coffee is Nescafe, yeah, their creamer brand is not doing great. Okay, that's enough. And creamer brand is, you know, that mark, the creamer brands, creamer markets are not growing. Neither the Nestle's creamer brand has a very small, you know, market share in the low growth brand, right? But they are not kicking it out because that has a relationship with the with their top brand, which is Nescafe. Yeah, Nescafe is their top brand. So with Nescafe, there's a relationship. So they don't want to kick it out. That's number two. Number three, see whether that can be relaunched back again. See whether it can come back, like your sunglasses models. Yeah, I don't know what is the model that is prevailing now, because now it's very difficult to see people with the sunglasses. Also, it's so expensive. Whether if you have your sunglasses, whether it is like, you know, like the goggles which covers your entire face or whatever, keep that, because you can give that to your granddaughters. Okay, so because the fashion will come back again. Now, when time goes on, you will get back to this, you know, old Rukmani Devi style. You know, things will come back. So don't when you see that there's an opportunity to relaunch the brand, relaunch the product, and whether there is an opportunity that it will come back, hold it on. Okay, don't kick it out, right? A lot of companies do that, right? And they make good profits, because when others are thinking that they have already have something in their hand to move forward. Okay, so that is very important to think. So prepare your portfolio. Now, this is one of the corporate models, corporate decisions, what they have to make. Yeah, identifying their portfolio, what portfolio they have. These sizes, you could see the B is the biggest in the size and E is the smallest, is the investment that you have made. Okay, investment what you have made, and the positions are where you are standing currently. Okay, you can identify whether you are in a pretty good position, whether your size is good, whether you can see the relative market share and the industry growth, where A, they are not completely there. They are, probably it seems like they are moved from a question mark into the star category now. But if the C is also going to move, it will be below. A, but the market growth, the industry growth is less in the C category. Yes, that's how it has to be read, right? Where on the A category, the growth is high, but the relative market share has not been obtained. The right market share has not been obtained. So that means they are not number one, okay? But fairly amount of investment is there. So you can draw it up with your investment size also. Then you can make your decisions appropriately to which portfolio that your investment is going to be made. Okay. Right. So that's on your corporate level and the business level that we have finished off. Then we are getting into the international aspect of it. Let me go through for your recap basis, because this is something that, you know, they might even like they could ask, or maybe there is some potential that they might think that, you know, your unseen might carry, then you need to get ready. Yeah, you need to get ready for that particular perspective also. The first one, when you go into any particular country, Porter once again identified there are certain elements that you need to see whether they are staying stable, right? Four major, variables he identified, four major variables. Number one is factors of production, right? That is like, you know, he divided that factors of production into basic and advanced, right? Basic is like, you know, non-skilled labors, your location, your all those aspects of it, right? And the advanced factor conditions are skilled labors, knowledgeable labors, education level, proximity, the infrastructure development, telecommunication development, you know, all this perspective, right? If you think of the Sri Lankan, you know, what the area, what we are good at, we are our number one export earner is we are the garments. We are very good in that. We have that factors of production brilliantly settled in, to be very honest. Okay. So that's why we are not manufacturing for locals. Okay. We are manufacturing for outsiders. So the demand condition, the next one, demand condition, one of the requirements for that organization when they come in and to stay, the products should be sold into the market. In Sri Lankan, value-added garment industry, that's my special name for the garment industry. We are only value-adding, okay? We are the value-addition garment industry, because we bring the fabrics and we manufacture, we add value, we create the product and we sell it off, yeah? That value-added garment, those products, what is manufactured, have been taken out to the market quickly and they have been sold, okay? So the demand conditions would require a good taste, a good demand. People know what it is. Now, if you even take the Sri Lankans, I believe we know the difference between high quality brands and the low quality brands, okay? I mean, no brands. We know the difference between, you know, whether this product would stay put like that for a longer period of time and whether it can be used for a longer period of time. It's easily understood, okay? Because we know it, we have the knowledge, right? Why Apple is surviving very well in US, because there is a good demand for that. Apart from the international market, it has a local demand. Our value-added garment industry is created for the externals, not for internals. So that is moving, right? Third one, the related and supporting industry. Imagine the related and supporting industries, what we have to support this value-added garment industry. The button manufacturers, the label manufacturers, the packaging manufacturers, the cargo, all are in very highly linked situation, isn't it? Our supply chain is excellent, right? So everything what is linked to that, you know, we could even book the space and time it and send it to the port for the export purposes, because we are ready for that, okay? So that is also to be checked up. Then your firm strategy, structure, and rivalry. We have top class rivalry in that particular industry, isn't it? Yeah. MAS, Brandex, Hydra Moneys, Hela, you name, they are, isn't it? Like they are competing with each other, they are innovating, their innovation rate is pretty good. Their strategies are so good, you know, they were able to acquire the resources very well. Yeah. The structure, which we have it in our case also. Yeah. The structure of the industry is such. So all these things are supporting that value-added garment industry. So that is one of the reason most of the people wants to come and settle here. Yeah, most of the people like to give their business to, you know, the Sri Lankan production people, because we manufacture. Other aspects coming in, okay? Other aspects are coming in. Informal institutional cultures, quality. We manufacture quality. We respect people. We pay the right wage to our employees. We empower females who have been looked down in different societies. Yeah. And also although these people these organizations as a very strong rivalry, as a whole they could dictate terms to the, you know, the authorities. You know, they have that they have that, you know, apparel manufacturing producers forums are there, right? With this, you could see we could have problems with GSP Plus because of political reasons. Yeah, so politics also could be important. Now, don't get me wrong, GSP Plus is a politically motivated. Anybody can say anything, but that is a political motivated, okay? It's a politically motivated tool that people can be used. Yeah, so if you have to, and that has been given on various perspective. So now those kind of thing, that is for pure example. Now don't take me anywhere else. Yeah, it's an example what I'm giving. So there are the politically also, it will support the growth of those particular industries to go off it. Okay, so that's very important. So if you're looking at the strategies, what they want to do internationally, whether you can go either export, you can be multi-domestic, you can be global, you can be transnational. Yeah. Now this is how it is. You need for your global integration versus your local responsiveness. Whether you want to do a high local responsiveness with a low global integration, you'll do a multi-domestic strategy. The next slide will explain to you all these things, so don't worry. Just imagine where they are standing now. If your need for integration is very high and local responsiveness is low, you can go for global strategy like Coca-Cola. If you're thinking of both the integration as well as the local responsiveness, both has to be high to get the best out of the product, you can even work on transnational strategies, where most of the multinationals are now moving towards transnational. Even the multinationals who had multi-domestic strategies, now they are moving towards transnational because of the cost pressure. You can see multi-domestic, country cultural difference needs to local responsiveness. So you have to have, right? So where the people would prefer with local responsiveness. Now this is where I believe Unilever also brought in their herbal toothpaste, okay? Because the Sri Lankans are very much addicted, or they really go for anything when you say herbal, okay? Nothing herbal in anywhere, to be very honest, okay? Nothing herbal in anywhere. Everything is essence to go for. They can say that they are adding, but the percentage what they are adding naturally, it's very, 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 very minute. Yeah, very minute. Global strategy, key assumption is that you don't have to worry about local responsiveness. You can just go ahead and bring in that global advantage, like Coke. Yeah, but even Coke has a very slight variations from different parts of the world. Okay, some countries would like to have a little bit more sugary. Some country would like to have that little more biting, that zinc aspect of it. So they have that very slight variation in their product going in. Yeah, but still they would acquire that same bottles, same color, same marketing aspect of it, so to get that global advantage. Transnational, as I said, that they would want to go both elements in. Yeah, both elements in. Now you could see multi-domestic. Now Unilever is transiting, okay, from multi-domestic to transnational. Now they are because of the cost pressure, right? They need to, so they are looking into where they could manufacture a bigger region, bigger element. So if they have a go with Indian market or Bangladeshi market or Pakistan market, and or if they can sell for that entire market, then they might take our products also, because they know that it can be sold on a larger scale. Okay, then they can get that benefit by manufacturing on a bigger bulk, right? Cimex, another global building material company, they are not much bothered about the other market conditions, so they would give you the best product wherever locations you are, which would match the requirement. Transnational, for example, like the Starbucks in China, okay? So they are now, they want to get that benefit of the global benefits, innovation, and also they would see the local requirements to go off with, yeah, local responsiveness as well. So PIA, if they want to go international, they need to consider the location where they want to go off, and also they can consider the type of ways that they can go. So either exporting, either licensing, either again by strategic alliance, or acquire a company over there, or even go in newly build your own a greenfield investment rather than a brownfield investment. So greenfield investment, you go and invest a complete new factory. Brownfield, of course, it's like the acquisition. So you can take over what is already existing. So you could decide and take whatever you want to, if you're thinking of any international aspect. Few risk, political, economic risks are there. Politically, we have seen that, we have security issues, we have instability issues in different countries. There is high potential for assets to be nationalized. So the policies of the you know, the governments regarding the protectionism. So now these are the few political issues that you might face, and also economy issues where you might not be able to recover your money. You might be able to not send out the money what you want. There might be price controls. There might be foreign exchange issues. So there would be so many different kinds of issues also might come in when you're operating in that particular areas. When you have an IN product, you might even face with counterfeits. Yeah, so that also would be another problem which might impact your sales. Right, so once you have worked on these, then we can look into the valuation part. So the way forward from this particular point is to see how we could create strategies, then evaluate it, then if we require the change onto the implementation. The TOES matrix is the what I could say is like it's a modification of the SWOT analysis, SWOT matrix, what you have created. Okay, now you are going to list it out. Can you see, like, you know, you have, when you identify strength and weaknesses, opportunities and threats, that's what I said, like, come with a list so that you know you can start creating certain strategies for BIA. Okay, if you can, it would have been ideal if you could do it for individual SBUs, so that you know you can be ready, as well as you can have a overall perspective as well, right? So you can list out, name it, list out. Then you can start off with strategies, like you can see strengths, opportunities, SNO, yeah. So strengths and opportunities. Then you create that SO strategies. W and opportunities, you create this WO strategies. S and T, you create ST strategies, combination. We will do an example, don't worry about it. And W and T, you will create this WT strategies. Okay, so now let's see how this works. This is coming from actually your as I said earlier, this is coming from your SWOT matrix, right? So once you have from the SWOT matrix, you're going to combine this. Fundamental questions you need to be asked. Number one, how can my internal strength, yeah, whatever I have, now say for example, you have a very strong leadership and you have a high quality conscious employees and the management. That, How can I exploit that with the external opportunities? People are looking for high-end products. They're investing a fairly big amount in the products what PIA operates. So therefore, they might want the high-quality products. So my organization is branded as a quality-conscious organization. With that, I can produce products with that brand name so that, you know, people can accept it. So looking for opportunities where, whether related or unrelated diversification, you can sell your brand. Yeah, sell your brand name. Yeah, because your organization is respected for quality. Same thing with the others. How they can benefit from their strengths to avoid the threats what is coming up. One of the threats, for example, okay, one of the threats on employment per se is finding good people, qualified people, experienced people in the market, technically qualified. You can find for the moment you can find commercially qualified people like y'all. Yeah, you can still find people. Okay, still we can find people like accountants. We can find people with management aspect of it. It's very difficult to find people with technology tech aspect of it, like the production management, production aspect of it. That's why they are given, saying that, he is qualified on the production management. It's very difficult. Okay, that's a local market now. That's a current market. Number two, migrations. Plenty of people are migrating. That this has nothing to do with COVID, okay? Because your case, last page says, unless otherwise specified of COVID, unless specifically referred to this case study, COVID-19 impact to be ignored, okay? So migration is not because of COVID, okay? Migration has now accelerated, right? So now this could be threats because you can't find right people to manage your organization. You might struggle to get people. What do you do with your internal strength? You have already having good people. Your people are working towards achieving the goals and targets. Keep them. So this is what you do, ST strategies. Keep them, motivate them. Yeah, because that's how you can mitigate the threat. Because one of your strength is your employees. Yeah. So therefore, you might have to see whether any weaknesses might hinder. Now, Sumal, the way he is managing might be a problem. And the way the organization is being managed might be a problem. Although it's at the top level, it's a different culture, and the bottom level is a totally different culture. Top level, maybe you're talking about a participative leadership style, but at the bottom level, there is no participative leadership style. You listen what I'm telling you. Yeah, that's what it is. So it's pure autocratic way. And it's completely transactional leadership. I pay you if you achieve. Yeah. I'm not coming into just conclusions. Okay. I'm coming into conclusions with the information what is provided in the case. Yeah. With the wordings what the case has been talking about. Every time support your argument. Every time support why they are saying it. The case says so, not me. Master is not saying, okay. That's very important. Don't assume things. Go with the case, word by word, line by line. Go with the case. Understand what they're talking about. So they might have a subculture within the main culture, which is acceptable by the senior management team. That's what they're saying. Because their value sets that way. Their values itself, they're talking about it. In their values itself, that they are very specifically saying. Responsibility supported by authority, accountability for those responsible, and they're saying never lose control of values. Now, this is where the conflict also comes in. And end of it, profits are key to survival in the world of business. So profit also must be there. We know when you have to go for profits, you might have to sacrifice certain things. So ethics, what we sell, how we sell, to go for the profits, whether that is compromised. We don't know, okay? We don't know. So how do we solve this, right? So let's look at this. Okay, read through these strategies. How do we solve, to get into that. I want to go into the example quickly. Now, when you see the this particular, when you create this one, okay, have it in your write it down or draw it off. Okay, I'm giving you some examples here. Let's say partnering up with educators. Now this is one of the organizations, okay, which we did. Partnering up with educators by offering apprenticeship positions. Now look at the case. Your strength is there's a large group of very experienced professionals working within the organization who have a lot of expertise. Yes or no? We have. This is one of our strengths also. Okay. And currently, you know, there are private and public organizations who would want the vocational people that are looking for apprenticeship positions. Now, you find difficult to manage employees, if you find difficult to work with them, now you can partner with them. So you can bring in employees. Now, this is one way that you can reduce your cost, okay? But then you have to look at the ethical perspective. So your employees at different levels, since there is a demand in the market, okay, you have to find out, guys. This hypothetically, I'm creating this scenario. I'm sure that this prevails in Sri Lankan context as well, because there are organizations looks for this apprenticeship. So you can bring these motor mechanics who are learning. Say, for example, from German Tech, yeah, from NITA. Yeah, from NAB. So there are people who are joining with the government. Yeah, bringing them. And even you can support for the people who are on the drug rehabilitation camps, the way forward to them. Yeah, which will be regarded as a CSR, good CSR project. Amalgamating them into the society. Think of it, guys, okay? So with that strength, people can work under this expertise, and you will need these people, this type of people to work. Yeah, that's one. Look at the weakness. The organization takes little initiative when it comes to customer acquisition and waits for customers to come to them. Why I'm saying that? If you read the case, they are not very happy with, you know, advertising. They say, you know, if you just advertise and the customers knows everything, so they are not going to be attracted toward these false promises. Yeah, they say in that case. Yeah. So now, how do I link that? Now you can show the world, you can show the the people that you are a CSR based helping the Sri Lankan society, these products are being created and handled by differently able people, so that you could have that demand. So you could, when you talk about it, people would think twice. Won't you do that? Won't you see a high quality product which they say this is done by a unprivileged segment of the people who were amalgamated and trained into the system, and now they are producing it, don't you feel that, you know, you are going to buy that product? Definitely you will buy that. Definitely you will buy that. Now this is where this CSR, so little initiative, they have not done anything, isn't it? They are talking about it, right? They're saying that, you know, the PIA is not involved in that. Yeah. So they could do this. Now, this is something I just created with the, you know, when this case of finishing products, okay? Finishing products. You could see the fantastic graph, which was drawn by Nalaka, which shows the quality of the product and the expense incurred. And when you see the end, yeah, kiln drying, cutting, machining, assembling, and finishing, then finally the inspecting, that finishing is the area where they are looking at, you know, to reduce the cost. Yeah. So finishing is that quality comes in with the finishing part. So if you're going to have that, you can have these workers, you know, with getting them the cheaper polishing workers who look for work, who has work. Okay. So now this is then once again linked with, now this is how you can create these strategies, okay, to see how you could reduce the cost as well. Because the way I'm seeing here in this case is all about managing an organization. We'll come to that. We'll come to that. Okay. We're looking at the WT strategies. So increasing cheaper labor is available, cheaper labor is working on with. You can show that, you know, you're working with people who are onto that kind of apprentice, where you're not dropping, you know, people into different levels. So you're taking care of the people, giving a different perspective to your business. Yeah. Right. Okay. Let me, because I just, recently I had to do something for a hotel. Yeah. I did a small analysis about the hotel, you know, and to see how we could create that particular aspect. So I drew up some opportunities, strengths, and weaknesses, and threats, because they had some finance issues, they had some cost-cutting issues, they had some managerial issues, they had some staffing issues. So all these issues were there. So then that's why they wanted us to help them out to see what they could do. So we came up with this. So we did a analysis part, and you can see how I have identified, you know, Q1, 01, 02, 03, 04, 05 here, right? You can see on this, right? And that is represented over on the other side. Okay, you can see S1 and S2. W1, W2, I put it in order. So that is there in this, you can see this, yeah, right? So you can see, then how do I work it out? The opportunities, actually, I picked it up from the PESTEL and Five Force framework, from the external analysis, even the threats as well. Strength. This is a pick from the internal analysis. So by doing a resource audit or the value chain or whatever, right? So these are picked up. So combining your strength and opportunities. So I'm combining S1, that is a strategic location, and O3, which is tourist arrival increasing. Okay. Indians and Chinese, especially, they're increasing. So I'm saying, promote your location, benefit of your location to the markets where the tourists are coming from, especially India and China. Yeah, so this would be one option. So focus on these two markets and promote your location itself, because what do you see? What do you want to do? Like, you know, if you want to relax, if you want to work off it, do you like to go and get into a crowded place or you want to be exclusive? For me, I want to be exclusive. Yeah, because for people who come to Sri Lanka, now there is something that Sri Lankan are struggling to provide, the privacy, the exclusiveness. Okay, all our beaches are filled with trouts. Okay, there are more and more people roaming on the beach, right? So you know, it's a plus and a minus, whatever the way. But then, you know, a person can't peacefully be in the beach. Yeah, so that's something that, you know, you have to be aware of. That's something that, you know, Sri Lankans can't give, which is being provided by the Maldivians. Okay, in Maldives, that's what it is. They have nothing except the beach, but the beach what they provide is with privacy, right? So for example, a hotel which is in an island, maybe 2-3 kilometers radius, okay, or 2 kilometers radius, right, circumference, sorry. Then, you know, if they have only about 30 couples or 40 couples, because 40 rooms, right, then you're looking about 100 meters difference between each people who are on the beach. They're not going to be worried about, there is no outsiders, no one, everybody has come there to relax and everybody would have their own cool time. Yeah. So the employees are not going to disturb them unless otherwise they have asked to come and provide them the meals at the beach or whatever. So they will just leave them there. That's something that Sri Lankans can't afford, we can't provide, unfortunately. Then if your hotel is strategically located, okay, where by nature it's giving you, it doesn't give access to outsiders to get into your beach area, come on, sell that. That is what you have to sell. Yeah. And combine that with market penetration. Go and sell more. Sell more and show them that you are different. This is what you can offer. And also just, so next strategy what I'm proposed, what I proposed is like S2O3. S2 isn't, these are new hotels, okay? These are new hotels. That's one of the reasons that they are struggling also. These are new hotels. O3, again, new arrivals. So go and talk to them, go to their markets, tell them these are brand new hotels, not the old ones, not the torn ones. I don't want to see my bed sheet is torn. I don't want to see my toilet that is moles. I don't want to see, you know, there's breaks in the tiles. I don't want to see water dripping from my AC. Come on, these are new hotels. Develop that, because that's something very, very important. And also, with that perspective, new hotel, strategic location, go and get into markets where the people are not coming from. Because see, if you see, the people who are coming from India and China, where they have direct routes, okay, where there are direct flights, especially in China. India, of course, we have some certain, we are covering top, destinations where people could travel, like the Bangalore and Chennai and Mumbai and New Delhi. We cover those routes, and including now Kolkata as well, I believe. So, go to those existence, go to those routes. Don't wait for the same market, your Delhi market to come or the Mumbai market to come here. You're not attracting the Chennai market. There are enough people in Chennai who could afford to come with a different perspective, because the way Sri Lanka has been projected into South India is like, oh, don't go there, terrible. Yeah, but actually not. When they come, they are shocked to see. So go and market develop. So I just want to touch with some examples so that you know you could know, yeah, how that could have an impact. This is another company. I was thinking about the soup company, are totally manufacturing based, but then different product. Yeah, you can see the strength, current profit ratio increased, employee morale is high, market shares increased, something similar to the PIA. The opportunities, Western European unification, rising health conscious, demand for soup. So what we have done is like to see the strategies that we can create, combining different S1, S3, and O1, like acquire food company in Europe because of O1, that is the opportunity one, because now the Europe is one, so that, you know, you acquire any company in Europe, then you don't have to get any license. You can sell it anywhere you want in Europe, okay? Why you are doing that? Because you have enough money. Can you see that? O1, enough money. And also, there's a demand increasing for soup, S3. So combining the opportunities with your strength, you create one strategy and you tell them. So that will help you in growth. That will help you in market. So what you are doing basically, you're going in organically because you're going with your profits and you're acquiring, okay? So that means you're doing a quiz acquisition, right? For a product. For what? You're going into new markets. Yeah, earlier you would have been operating only in the UK. Now you can operate in Europe. So total new market, because you have that ability to develop that soup. You're pretty good. The employee morale will be high because employees are very happy. Then now they see that there might be an opportunity for them to work overseas as well. Right. Same way. Go through this, guys. So I'm not going to go into each and every detail, but the combination and the logic would be there. Once you create the strategies, you need to evaluate the strategies. Okay, the evaluation of the strategies to go off with. So I would pick up this SAF criteria, suitability, acceptability, and feasibility criteria for evaluation, right? Suitability. Fundamental questions. Ask these questions. If you have the answers, then it's fine. Does the proposed strategy address the key opportunities and constraints an organization faces? Now, the key words here is the key. Not opportunities, okay? Key opportunities. Because you would have identified in your SWOT matrix everything. Major strength, minor strength, major issues, major threats, minor threats, whatever you would have identified. Okay? You would have identified big opportunities, small opportunities, big threats, small threats. So here, the first question, is your strategy, what you're proposing, addresses, that means whether you can grab that biggest opportunity which has been provided by the market. If it is yes, then go ahead. That is number one. Do not false or alter on that, because that's something very very much required, because that's why you did an analysis about what is happening in the market to identify. Yeah. So then you must make use of that information to go ahead. That's one. Number two, acceptability. Does a proposed strategy meet the expectation of the stakeholders? Expectation. We know that stakeholders have conflicting goals. Employees wants more profit, shareholders want more salary, shareholders wants more profit. So if you give more salaries, shareholders' profits might go down. The share might go down. You want lower cost raw materials, the supplier would want high price. So if you provide high price, your cost of production will go up. Then if you have to keep the same profit margin, you increase the price, the customers are not going to be happy at the expense of the supplier. So all the stakeholders have a conflicting requirements. So will your strategy at least match the key stakeholders? The key stakeholders' expectation. Because we analyze and see who are the stakeholders. That's what we did earlier. Okay. We have to identify and analyze who are the key stakeholders. The level of risk is acceptable. On a simple note, then we know risk and return. Yeah. So we have to analyze the risk and the return. Whether the risk is according to the return, or the return is higher than the lower risk, that will be the higher situation. Low risk, high return. Everybody will like it. Is it high risk, low return? Then, not only whether the strategy meets the expectation, whether the stakeholders will accept it. Now, especially when it comes to the implementation, the staff. If you don't have a proper structure, if you don't have a proper systems, now the staff will be penalized to work more. They will be taxed more. Yeah, so they're not going to be happy about it. So have you provided all the facilities? Have you worked out a new working methodology, working system, so that people will be happy about it? They don't complain about the work. Yeah. Have you provided them enough training? Have you provided them training with the equipment? Have you provided the training with the systems? So have you kept them on the loop so that they know what the changes have been made? This is only with the employees I'm talking to. Now, what about the other stakeholders? Yeah. As far as the main shareholders will be concerned, and especially like the organization like PIA, the founders would not want that to happen, that family, the main strategic management team would not want anything to happen to going against their seven values. Yeah, they don't want to go against that values and principles. So anything to do that, you're looking at profits are the key to survival. Then if any project comes in with low profits, very very little profits, then they might think. Whereas that might increase the morale, it might increase the image of the organization, it might give you a long-term perspective, the higher profitability. Still, it might not be rejected. It might be rejected. So you need to match that. Feasibility. Whether this will work in practice, whether this could be acceptable in practice, whether it is possible. Can you find the finance? I don't think there's a problem with finance here. Yeah, because we have seen the capability of the major shareholders and also the trust and ability with the banks, the properties what they have. So, they don't have a major problem in raising finance. Do we have enough resources? Whether the products, if you're trying to manufacture a new product, whether that product could be manufactured, and do you have enough resources to manufacture the product? Whether those resources could be accessed, whether there's a market, whether there is you know, whether it is possible to get. Otherwise, no point, right? And is our employees able to manufacture? Do they have enough knowledge, their skills, their skill levels? Or can I get them from outside? What will have the complications if I bring the new people into my organization? Now, that will not be a problem in the PIA case because PIA wants the organization to manage professionally. Now, these are the things what will be the repercussions, what you are looking at. So answering these 9 questions would satisfy, you know, whether whatever you are proposing, whatever the strategy that you are proposing, whether it is acceptable. Now, let me just go to one of those strategies, like say, for example, go to your market segment and promote your new hotel because of the new criteria. Does that address the key opportunity? Yes, because one of the opportunities is the tourism market is improved by the Indians and Chinese coming in. Fortunately or unfortunately, the current increase what we see is not from the Indians and the Chinese. The current increase is from the Europe. Because of the climatic conditions what they face, the harsh conditions what they face right now there. Already, St. Petersburg, the northern area, that section has gone into minus. They are expecting this time to be a long freezing bad winter. So hopefully, we will have enough tourists coming in. So yes, suitable. Does the proposed strategy meet expectation of stakeholders? Obviously, if it is new arrivals coming in, the employees will be happy, the shareholders would be happy, the government would be happy, everybody would be happy. The risk level, whether it is acceptable, what are the investment that you are going to make? It's a promotional campaign. Probably you might have to participate in a tourism place like ITB Berlin, whether you have anything to do in India, or go and promote with the help of your national carrier, with the main agents identified. Go and do a roadshow. What are the cost? Not much. Have strategically aligned others, other partners, other hoteliers. Yeah. So if those could be answered with the criteria, then you're fine. Suitability, just to go in a little bit detail, the rationale of the strategy, okay? As I said, whether it exploits the opportunities. Not only exploiting the opportunity, whether I am able to utilize the strength of my organization. Few examples. From the environment, what might be suitable in terms of the environment? If you're looking at the market penetration, gain market share for advantage. On your capability, exploit superior resources and capabilities. So penetrate the market. That's a direction I'm giving. If I want to do product development, looking at the environmental aspect of it, exploit knowledge of customer need, and we are in the capabilities, you exploit the R&D. So can you see, when I suggest product development, actually I'm exploiting the opportunity given in the market, that is to exploit knowledge of customer needs, yeah? And my strong capability, which is exploiting R&D. Yeah. So therefore, this is suitable. So few screening techniques, what you can do, like you can rank them. You can rank them to see which one is better, which one is good at that particular time. And you can use the scenarios, decision trees, life cycle analysis. Second one, acceptability. Whether the expected performance, you saw that, yeah? For the proposed strategy, accepted by the stakeholders. Acceptable return, acceptable risk, and the stakeholder reactions. So on the risk, it could be financial ratio, sensitive analysis that you can work on your finances to see, and also the accepted return, you can look at your NPV, discounted or the payback, ROC, the cost benefit. If it is a project, the real options, where do you increase the shareholder value? So your finances could be worked on here. So if you're looking closely, yeah. So your risk, your returns, and your reaction of stakeholders. Because we need to see that they are also linked into that. You have to see the must understand what is happening, especially in PIA. You have to understand these political agendas. Feasibility. Finally, financial feasibility, resource feasibility, and whether this strategy is possible to do with the existing organizational structure and with the existing organizational processes, whether it is possible. If not, then it's a problem. Yeah. I remember, you know, we were consulting a firm and we were talking about the organization. The organization saw an opportunity in a expansion into a overseas country. The market was very good. They removed one of their best salesperson from here and dumped him over there. He never wanted to go. Yeah. When he went over there, another organization picked him, offered him triple the amount of salary, because now he never wanted to go from here because of, you know, his commitments and family commitments. Now he evaluated to see whether it is worth for him to take that particular job, because it's three times more for the risk what he's taking. Now he could take the entire family over there. So they lost that person. So that if you don't have that existing structure, and in the meanwhile, they lost the sales here also, because there was no one to replace him at that level. So you need to be careful. You need to be, even the opportunity is there, even the feasibility has been done. If you don't have that, you know, that the structure is not in place. Yeah. So you need to be careful. Yeah. Funding, cash flows, financial strategies. We could see financial strategies heavily spoken in our case. I want you to touch upon this balance scorecard for some reason. Yeah. The reason being, your case is being handed over to a consultant to talk about the business situation and how it is going. Bit difficult to understand, but then that's why non-predictability comes in, and I don't predict anything. So because of that, it made me to talk about this balance scorecard also. Organization is engrossed with performance evaluation. Yeah. they are engrossed with performance evaluation. They are talking about performance linked with reward. Performance linked with reward. And also they are talking about less on CSR activities. They are not worried about that. Yeah. The case says so. Okay. So in other words, because of that particular situation, I'm deriving that organization is looking at profits, which is in the case itself, and not how that profit is made. Whether those profits are made in the right way. What are the ways that they are contributing for those profits? I don't see evidence. So I thought of bringing this balance scorecard where it will give you a totally good perspective about how the profit is made. Four perspectives here. First one, how do customers see us? The customer perspective. What we must excel at, internal business process perspective, where this is something our top management is very much interested in. Cost savings. Number three, how can we improve? Yeah, in creating value. Yeah, that's your learning and growth perspective. And how does our shareholder looks at? Yeah, here actually the family, how does the family, Samuel and co family looks at? Yeah, the financial perspective. So seeing that, this is very interesting to, you know, to create this. Whereas, the balance scorecard has come a bit of a long way now. Okay. The balance scorecard, which talks about the four elements, which is linked to your vision and mission, has they try to interlink and create that vertical relationship between these four elements. First, learning and growth. Although all have relationship, interrelationship with each other, you could create that vertical elements also. Number one, learning and growth. Learning and growth is all about the employee development. Learning and growth is all about innovation. So employee development and innovation would have direct impact on internal business processes. So when I learn, when you can link, now this is the good part of the theoretical framework. The moment you link your stakeholder requirements with the organizational requirements, you win. That's why you do a stakeholder analysis. While doing a stakeholder analysis would give you the requirement of the stakeholders. When you know that, you know, your requirement of the stakeholders are coming in, then if you can link that requirements of the stakeholders with the organization requirement, now say, for example, organization requirement is profitability. You will have high profits if people work professionally, if they approach professionally. Now say, for example, your sales guy, if the way he approaches the customers, talk to them, convince them, knowing about the knowledge, all those things, if he has a good, sound knowledge about the business, understanding about the external aspect of it. So if he's been allowed to study, if he's been allowed to do his qualification, that knowledge would automatically that he will start picking it up faster than others who does not do any professional education. You have to accept that. Yeah. So let's say this guy wants to come to, now let's say he's based in Kandy and he wants to come to Colombo for weekend for classes. Now, of course, the classes are happening like online, so not a problem. But whereas your organization has a restriction that if you're based in Kandy, you can't come to Colombo without informing. You know, you're not supposed to leave your territory. Yeah. But then he's going to be unhappy. He can't continue his studies. So then, you know, he will not make any extra effort to bring in new sales. He will just meet his target. That's all. Nothing more than that. No innovation, no thinking, nothing about the competitive activities, nothing he wants to do. But if you could allow him, on a restricted note, come to Colombo and get back before Monday morning, then he will be happy about it because his main idea is to come and study and go. So studies would help him to gain more knowledge will help him to understand the market situation, help him understand the market situation will help him to understand the customers, helping to understand the customers would help to sell more. In return, that will impact your financial aspect of it, your profits goes up. So you're linked, your stakeholder, one of the stakeholder who is the employee's requirement with your final product, final goal, that which is more profits. So if you could link that, then it's fine. Same way here. Okay. Your learning and growth would improve your internal business perspective, your cost elements, your business processes, what happens, your utilization of resources. Your utilization of resources to the optimum level. Understanding about minimum order quantity. Understanding about safety stocks. Now we are talking about the entire manufacturing organization, right? We're talking about the entire manufacturing organization. We are two manufacturing organizations and one trading company, kind of. So we have the processes, we have the elements in it, how we could improve it. That knowledge is created, or that knowledge is passed on by making people more knowledgeable, more understanding about, and more innovations coming in. So your goal setting, probably, like, you know, you could see the structure what they have. A personal officer reports to the CEO. That's it. No major other aspect of it. They're only talking about the finances. Now, as a personal officer, some procedures, that's it. No training and development. So one of the goals that you can have is like having the people trained, developed, because their structure is now slow. Their promotions are slow. Next level, when they move on, you know, whether they're ready to take up the next level is slow. So all these things could be sorted out at this learning and development, learning and growth. That will have a direct impact on how you manage your resources, how you produce, the necessity to be cost saving, that aspect will come in. The delivery lead times, taking consideration of your customer's requirement, understanding the customer requirement, and delivering the products according to customer requirement, customer's perspective. Then your customers will be happy. He will become the ambassador. He will go and talk about outside that you, your organization, how they satisfy his need on time with the right product, with the right quality of the product. That's what the customer would want. Are you showcased in front of the customers? Already you are, okay? You have been looked upon as a high quality delivering organization. Now, if you could give them that option of, increase the profitability, the servicing them, because these products are like a long-term investment products. So give them the proper service you know, give them new ideas, innovative thinking. All these things would come in by improving our business processes. So the customers will be happy about it. Repeat purchases, word of mouth, improved products quality, more sales, your financials will improve. Your margins will improve because of the cost reduction. Your top line will improve because of sales improves. Now, this is where the balance scorecard could be an appropriate tool. This is my thinking into any businesses and also to PIA in case that they are looking on that particular perspective. Yeah. Right. Change. It does not just happens, okay? It does not just happen. It's a little bit more complex than, you know, just a plan, right? So any change that you're looking at, it has to be according to looking at new opportunities, new value adding activities. We saw that there are so many activities involved in the in our production, and the ethical perspective. Okay, so like respecting environment, eliminating pollution, reducing energy consumption, all these things, if it could come in. Yeah. Key issues. One is strategy matters. Yeah. So that means in identifying the need for change and the direction of change. So you have to see whether that's important. So your strategy matters, whether your direction is going to change from market development to product development now. The context matters, where you operate, what is the approach what you have to take in, because you can't handle a customer who is living in Colombo and who is living in a absolute rural area where you don't have any electricity. It doesn't mean that Colombo, all the parts of Colombo has electricity. Hopefully they should be having now. But that's how it is. The resistance, you need to be very careful. Because people don't want to change. You saw in PIA as well, furniture, we stay with furniture, not anything else, no partitioning, not very interested. And also leadership. Every level, it says. But unfortunately, we have right on top, that's it. Yeah. We are not talking about anything on the middle. We are not talking about anything on lower level leaderships. Because there is no one. All direct report is to the CEO. So we have to wait and see how it works. So this would be the issues that you might have to think about when PIA to change. Okay. When we implement a change, especially with PIA, if you have to suggest a change, we have to first make them to understand, number one, this is required. Yeah. And this is the reality. And also, it could be an opportunity or a threat if you don't. So you have to make a decision of that change to go from. Three categories of change: structure, technology, people. If you're looking at the structure, the authority levels, the relationship, coordinating mechanism, the job designs, the span of control, how many people you are managing. That's number one. Yeah. So currently looking at it, it's on a divisional structure, multi-divisional structure it is, with one function as a common function, which is finance. The technology, change in technology, your work processes, the work methods, the equipments. Still you are producing from Morotua. The people, the attitudes, the expectation, the behaviors. So that's very much related to the culture. These are the main areas that you might have to change. So now you have to see which area that you're looking at. Yeah. Which area that you're working also. Now, type of change that you want to go in, there are four types models to change, and also the way you want to change, the context of change. Either you can go on a force field analysis or a kaleidoscope. Yeah. The four types of change, the extent of change and nature of change. The extent of change is whether realignment, transformation. We will discuss that with the example, so don't worry. And the nature of change, whether it's incremental or big bang. The first one is adaptation. That is incremental change, but it's a realignment. Reconstruction, evolution, or revolution. Realignment. It's a less fundamental change. That means you don't have to worry about your culture change, or you don't have to worry about any other perspective. Yeah, no cultural aspect of it. But this adaptation needs to be done, right? Sorry, guys. Yeah. So this could be accommodated with existing culture and occur incrementally without any problem, okay? Think about a person leaving your department. What will happen immediately? What will happen immediately? Most of the time now, what I have seen in most of the organizations, that work is divided among the others. That's one way of reducing your cost, okay? And enhancing your job design. So your portfolio increases. So that means your exposure into different areas it's exposed. So nothing happens here majorly. You learn that particular part and slowly start working on it. That's one. Yeah. The reconstruction. You need to realign it, but with a big bang. A little bit more dramatic, yeah. So rapid change, but not the culture change. Huh? There's nothing to worry about the culture change. So just imagine you want to bring both your factory and your manufacturing plants, what you have in Morotua, as well as your the hydro motor pumps plant, both to one location. Just imagine. You need to do it in a hurry. You need to do it in a big way, quickly. Yeah, but it's a realignment. Imagine like the government gives you a massive land outskirt of Colombo. Now say Ratmalana, because it is within the Colombo district, so maybe they want you to move out of Colombo district. No more things to operate, like no factories to operate. So let's to move outside, or you want to relocate that Morotua plant to where there is your electro plants are. That's a reconstruction. The transformation and incremental, which is evolution, once again, it can be there's a cultural change, but then you need to, you can achieve it in a step by step, slowly. Why you're going on an evolutionary path, right? People talk about evolutionary from the monkeys to the man. You know, I have my reservations and challenge for that. Yeah, but monkeys to the man. Yeah, this is like changing the mindsets and the ways of working of a well-established long service workforce, like typically at PIA. Slowly, you have to talk to them incrementally, slowly change things out. Yeah. Fourth one, revolution. Fundamental change, both in your strategy as well as your culture. Yeah. Huge. This is generally impacts everything in the organization. Impacts the structures, impacts the processes, impacts the people. Yeah. And also probably maybe acquiring new technologies also. So it's everything is been, everything has an issue here. Force-field analysis, you are talking about understanding what are the forces which supports you and what are the forces which resist the change. So presently where you are, because of these two forces are equal, the forces does not give you, there is no change, there is no, it's not happening anything. So if you reduce the restraining forces strength, then the forces which are driving, they could drive the change very quickly and move to the place where you want to go. Think of tug of war. Okay. It's like two sides are pulling, right? And you're in the middle. So if you want to move to one side, the red line to move to the other side, the force from the, let's say for the left side, the people who are pulling from the left side should pull much more faster or harder, or the people who are pulling from the right side should give up. Same technique here. So understand the forces and then either you reinforce them or you reduce them. If people are differently, there is no clear direction, people are talking through the grapevines, the change what is taking place and everybody is getting confused, that's one of the restraining forces. Therefore, best is to talk to them openly, explain to them, take section by section, talk to them the same thing, no word change, then the things will settle down. Yeah. So the force which came from that particular side will be reduced now. That's one. The other aspect, that the changing process is understanding, freezing, unfreezing, and the changing element. On a very simple note that it can be explained, you're looking at, hang on for a minute, you're looking at, the ice cubes at home, okay? Ice cubes at home. Now, let's say you want to change those ice cubes into different shapes and colors of different shapes and colors of what do you call you have to make some again in different shapes and colors. So what you do first, what you do then, you take it out, okay? You take it out and leave it to melt, because you want to use the same water. Okay, you take it out and leave it to melt. So when you take it out and leave it to melt, then the next step, now the water is melted. Now the ice cubes are melted. Now water is in the water form. Now you take little quantities. You would pour them into the shapes and add colors. Now say, for example, either yellow or green or blue or whatever the colors you want to add, and put it back again into freezer. Same way in your changing style. You start off by unfreezing them, talking to them and telling them what is the benefit because of the change, what are the benefit that you will get, what are the other implications that you will face if you don't change. So you will start unfreezing them. Then you make the necessary changes once they are ready. After that, once you make the necessary changes, then you reinforce them for that particular change. You know, a good example I can give you is like when people went on to the attendance system. A lot of organization went on to the finger scanning. We did it, when I was working for the multinational, we did it sometime back about 30 years ago. Yeah, we did that change. At that time, we had so much of problems. People are saying that, we get cancer, when you scan, this is illegal, that, all these things. So we had to bring in people from ILO to explain to them, because that system was new at that particular time. So to explain that it is not a problem, we had to bring people from cancer hospital, the doctors, to come and tell them, it has nothing to do with the cancer, all these things to, and then we took some sample of people. And we spoke to them and said to them, what are the benefits that, they could derive from this? I would say, for example, the leave balance or the overtime rates or whatever can be got from this particular login without a problem. Everybody will have the login, even the leave and management and things like that. On the other aspect, we spoke to the staff that way, and we spoke to the managers also. Managers were not logging in and logging out at that particular time. So then putting them into that particular system, they were feeling like, their privilege is being withdrawn. We said, no, it's just an attendance, not an attendance system. It's a access system. So if you want to come into office, you just place your finger, the door will open. Automatically, the number of hours you are in and out will be calculated, but then it's not going to be monitored. Yeah, so obviously, for the managers, it was that privilege. So, and nobody misused it, but then that's how it goes. So we explained to them, unfroze them. Then we made the necessary changes. We trained them to how to clock in, clock out. We showed how to look for their data, apply leave, approval of leave, all those things we trained them. So we made the necessary changes. Then once the changes are made, then we had to reinforce it. We had to put them back into the freezer. Yeah. So we held a competition. First 50 people who completes everything for that particular month, who comes with the perfect records, first 50 people would get, a bonus, a attendance bonus kind of thing, or a system bonus or something. We created a name for that and we gave it. I can't remember now. So that, everybody took an initiative to make sure that, they clock in properly, clock out properly, because, sometimes, the finger scan accepts your finger, it rejects. So some people get sick of it and they move off, but some people stayed put because we kept somebody over there to rescan it and, made the necessary changes over there, making them to see that, that they are getting used to the system. So once they get used to the system, it's fine. Okay. Right. Okay. So that's about it. On the theoretical perspective, much as possible, I try to work something out. Now let's go into quickly go into this case itself with certain information what I could provide to you for the support of your analysis. Let's go on that. Yeah. Now, this is their task: independently review and advise regarding the business affairs and functionality of the group. So your the DCC is going to give a report, yeah, independent review, and they are going to give an advice regarding the business affairs and the functionality of the group now. Okay, that is what they are been asked to do, right? DCC. So this is what they have been asked to do. So this might give you an indication what you might be seeing in your unseen. Okay, this might be an indication what you might be seeing in your unseen, right? So therefore, don't predict anything. Okay, therefore, don't predict. So this is an indication that what you could see in your unseen. Okay, but then you never know. Okay, the examiners could change the way we want. So they might even say, you know, that project didn't work out and it was cancelled, and you know, the new problem has come in. So that can completely change up, right? Just to brief something. So we know that PIA 1982, but then PHI was 1962, started off in mid 50s, and it's a SME. So we know if it is SME, how many number of people are there and the turnover. And it was initially formed for domestic water. So think on that, those areas also, what they were. Then 1997, furniture. Then 98, audio visuals came in. A few websites with regard to the the people who are operating in Sri Lanka, the suppliers, the buyers in Sri Lanka, where they the first one. The second one would go into the global water pump. You know, they planned to come into Sri Lanka way back in 2016. So probably these guys are already here. Then you will see the who are the people who are actually manufacturing and distributing water pumps in Sri Lanka. And there are some recommended suppliers by the water board. Okay, so not only why I took the water board is looking at the because we are supplying to water board, that is PIA is supplying to water board, so probably we also will be one of the suppliers to them, the recommended suppliers, so they will be our competitors. Okay, so they can be our competitors. So understanding, going through that list and understanding who they are, what type of things that they work on with, would give you a little bit more detail about the competitive analysis on the projects. Yeah, because they will be the direct competitors for you on the projects. Okay, so that's why I took this that particular link. The IMI, I think you all know what IMI is. Okay, the water management people, irrigation people in Sri Lanka, not in Sri Lanka, they operate in most part of the world as well. So there's a good working paper, but it's old, right? But still it goes as a working paper. It's old, not very old, but then you have some good details in that, okay, about the water purification, about the sanitization, with regard to the opportunity, what is there. There is good detail in that. Then this would give you an indication how many water pumps has been imported into Sri Lanka between 2000 to 2016. So beyond 2016, I could not find any details. If you all have any details, because this has been done in 2018. So until 2018, there would have been not very clearly details of, but this could be taken from customs. So if you all have any link with the customs, so please go and take it off. That will be very useful also to identify what are the market size and the numbers that could be produced by PHI and things like that. These now the water pumps have increased up to 2017 in Sri Lankan context of on agricultural purposes. So these are also the sources from Sri Lanka customs. From where these things are coming from, you can see imported water pumps, complete units, okay, complete units. In recent times, the China has taken over. 80% is coming from China, 5% from India, 2% from Japan, and 13% from other countries. Now, this is where I felt that, you know, we might fall into, we might not fall into this particular category immediately, but then in future, that, you know, there would be cheaper manufacturers, cheaper products might be in the market, so that, you know, when you see the, we come from the other area, that is 13%. So we might not be attractive to the market if we are trying to bring it down. But the manufacturing would help us reduction in pricing structure and the cost elements. So that also need to be considered. Factors influencing farmers selection. Now, this is why I included this was on your marketing element 1.6, I think, if I'm not mistaken. It says, 1.6 and 1.6. I'm reading from the third line. Also backed by years of reputed existence and powerful corporate brand image in the country, they are of the opinion that customers of the group's product are implicitly aware of the benefits of the items they purchase. Hardly can be influenced by the impressive promotions. So they don't want to. So the first line, first and second line very clearly says, companies are renowned for great quality and most offerings of the group are of the nature that involve rational bias evaluation. So this could be the rational bias evaluation. That's why I put it at 1.6 question mark. So the price, brand name, durability, quality. So you can see quality has come fourth, okay? Durability, number three. Price has been number one, right? So still, if you are maintaining something good with our prices, that means we are doing a good job, okay? So this is the same figure what I drew off with. The references are down. They are available on those lists what I gave you all, yeah? Countries that water pumps engines. Now these are engines, okay? These are not complete stuff. So you can see imported from and assembled locally, we might fall into this category, assembled locally category. So India 49, China 25, Japan and others 15 and 11. This is something I found with regard to what Demo is already talking about. Demo has already have something on the water solution, water treatment solution plant, EvoCure. So this is also pretty interesting because this is the area that they have talked about the opportunity. Okay, but remember, we have a giant already in that particular area in the business already. Okay, so that need to be taken into consideration. Because this is 2.2 related to 2.2, this particular information. Okay, these are the details about these water safety plans with regard to World Bank. There are enough news about Sri Lankan requirement. You can see that Sri Lanka needs new water and sanitation policies. So whatever they have shown here also could be there. So we can the PIA could involve in these projects. And there is other information also about the Sri Lanka. So please go through those reports. Just read them so you will understand roughly about what this opportunity, what has been spoken about in the case would come in. You could see here the monitoring of water safety and things like that, how good, bad, and different. So this would also would help you in with your data. Next is furniture. Few articles about furniture market in Sri Lanka, and also furniture market on e-commerce, because we are not in e-commerce in any aspect of it, and they are not talking anything about e-commerce, whereas technology is in your syllabus. So you might have to look into this also if you are going to go with the present context, where you could go on a very integrative website and e-commerce area. And, you know, they are given good information is there from this Statista about the e-commerce market, specifically in Sri Lankan context. So have a look at it and see, you can dig into more details about that particular aspect as well. Yeah. Then the previous article is about manufacturing and strategy improvement, so which also might be related to the cases what you're looking at. Strengths, history, well-run SME, good core values, managing business professionally, foreign affiliations. The purple, which I'm not very convinced of a strength, but then I'm considering a strength. Open door policy, because it is conflicting, because they are not encouraging, you know, it's a listen to me policy kind of thing. Merit and confidence for promotions. So does it, when you, and it clearly says if you're good with the senior managers, that you're, then you will be, you know, given everything. So I'm not very, you know, it's a conflicting statement. Fairness, equity, again, is a conflicting statement for me. Participatory style, that article would give you a good indication about what is participative style is. Okay, so understand that, whether, see whether that is suitable or whether it is practice or not practice, although they're talking about the participative style at the top level. Then on the weakness, just to identify, there are conflicts among the MDs and, you know, MD and deputy MD. The structure is very rigid to go off with. Sumal, managing, key managing personals, you know, salaries, wages, everything is handled by him. No HR involvement. So, and, you know, he's not updating himself on, you know, how to manage people as well. So being a pure accountant, he's an accountant. So that's what it's showing. So probably you might have to bring him to a good managerial level with information. These are my question marks, whether to go on strength or weakness, because focus on increased profit, whether it is good or bad. Because when you focus on profit, sometimes that you might go on a short-term perspective rather than a long-term perspective. Yeah, you might want to show a better ROC rather than, you know, looking at a long-term perspective, right? Rigid and adherence structure might not be, you might not be able to give you an agile fracture there, right? Your rewards are focused on sales. They're not talked about anything else. Others, how are they going to work on rewards? So if they are going to give only rewards to the sales force, the manufacturing, the other people who are working on the organization also might get upset over it. Yeah. Further, great quality meets the rational bias evaluations, powerful corporate image, annual budgeting process. That's a pretty good process what they have talked about here. And, you know, the clients premium, they can pay the premium and the long waiting clients for your, you know, your furnitures. Yeah. A limited amount of corporate advertising, promotion activities, social responsibility events are very limited. So I put that weakness over there. No expertise, PDCF, you know, the MD was talking about it, you know, not to give the entire control to the top management because they don't have the expertise on that. Then blue ocean strategy, is it still on for PABL? Okay. So you need to understand what blue ocean strategy is also. So I've given you the website to read through that. Sales price changes, I don't know whether it's good or bad. You as an accountant also would tell me. Top management team does not believe in impressive promotions, so marketing aspect of it. Standard costing is good. Is it correct? Is it plus? Is it minus for the organization? You have to make a decision, guys. Okay. Product development, they don't want to go into pantry. They don't want to go into office partitions. They are not very comfortable. So is it a weakness or is it a strength? Staying with your, you know, understanding your state core. You don't want to, you know, sticking onto your familiarity. So is it good, bad, ugly? Once again, you might have to think about it. Yeah. This is your structure, how it goes off. So your finance is managed by your what do you call your GDF. So the structure and CEO of PHI is also MD. So a bit of a conflicting role, I believe. So that need to be considered of your structure. So it's very clearly as a divisional structure with the functionals coming under them. Yeah. For each and every organization, also each and every sector, also they have the CEO is MD. Then you have the senior general manager handling projects. Then you have GM handling domestic and industrial one. You have for PDCF, you can see I'm not done the other part, the finishing part, assembly finishing, completing, and there was another element, if I'm not mistaken, there was one more finishing, yeah, inspecting, okay. The inspecting need to come in here, I will correct that and send it across to you all. So you have processes. So each and every processes, there could be new improvements coming in. So have an idea of what, where you can add value. Yeah. Once again, three SBUs under PABL, fairly decent, what they're going off with. So this is the structure within that particular place where they are dividing themselves into different product groups. Opportunities, I was able to grab only one, the main one, but there was few other opportunities which were talked about in the case also. For example, yeah. Marketing opportunities for PABL is there, so they are talking about that because the growth business were numerous, ranging from multimedias to major institutional conferences. So currently, whether that is there, I didn't take in that into consideration as an opportunity for the future, because that would have been the opportunity that they drove and grown. Yeah, so I don't know whether there's new opportunities provided. So check on the market situation. Yeah. Two strategies and concepts that they've been talked about is more about, you can see, structure, conduct, performance model, okay? Then strategy, structure, performance model. Then the environmental perspective model, then resource-based model. So what we did is a combination of the resource-based model and the structure, conduct, performance model, okay? So, read through these areas, right? So this is where it says your strategy, structure, performance model. When facing uncertain environments, firms tend to use competition strategies. That is, like, you know, whether you go on the price-based strategy or differentiation-based strategy, as well as cooperation strategies. We just finished that cooperation strategy also, right? So this is where it happens. So the firm conducts the cooperation strategy and possesses more resources, will attain better performance level than it does not. So even you go on cooperation with some other people, and if your processes are good, then it's a betterment, right? So that you need to keep in mind. Blue ocean strategy, once again, it simultaneously pursues differentiation and low cost, like the hybrid, but then you're removing the entire you know, the people out. The strategy in inter-organizational context, this is something which I, you know, the strategy structure and performance, you can see that. All these things have been fed by your external supply chain environment, okay? So you're doing an analysis on your end customer requirement, competitors, industry structure, economy, all these things we did, right? Which we feed into the strategy. Goal attainment, which is like, you know, the final profits to go off with, your technology, your communication, standardization, decision making, rewards on your structure, and your performance. I've given the link on the left side, so please visit that link. that's a very good working paper, which gives you an idea about that, you know, the strategy structure performance model, which they're talking about. Right. So you need to, things you need to do is like, we saw how the strategies are created, okay? How they are created as well. So when you look at the strategies how you are created, you need to see external analysis, then your internal analysis, your OOT and SW, then you convert that into TOS. Yeah. So your SWOT plus your TOS gives you a corporate level, whether your growth strategies, your direction with ANSOF, your international strategies, your portfolio, and your BCG matrix and G matrix to go off with. On the business level, you talk about Porter's and Bauman model. We discuss both. Then evaluation. Then finally, implementation. You can use Canvas or whatever the method that you want to go off with. Yeah. Yeah. So that's it from me, guys. And this will be available. I'll be sending it across to Aruna today, probably today evening or tomorrow morning. It will be available to you all. So do thorough work. And, you know, I believe that this would help you to an extent where you can, get through your finals. Yeah. Thank you so much for your patience listening, and take care. Be safe. Yes.